We're so glad you can join us.
If this is one of your first times worshiping with us, we invite you to participate in whatever way feels most comfortable for you, whether it's on your couch, at the kitchen table, or in bed in your favorite pajamas. We hope that you can experience God's amazing love.
We're going to sing a song together, and we invite you to sing along. Otherwise, you can just sit back and listen or watch. And after the song, we're going to hear from one of our pastors. We invite you to stay tuned after the pastor's message as well, to listen to some announcements and to find out how you can get connected. But before we do all that, I invite you to bow down your heads so we can pray together. Let's pray. God our Father, we thank you for an opportunity to worship you once again. We ask you, Father, that you be with us in our various homes and enable us to be connected through your Spirit. We thank you, O Lord, for such technology that makes this possible. And we ask, O Father, that you empower us and that your words may find fertile soil in our hearts. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Let's worship.
Nations rise and fall.
Good morning, Deepwater. Thank you for tuning in today. My name is Matthew, and I'm one of the pastors here. And we're starting a brand new sermon series called Invisible Enemy. Invisible Enemy. And I don't know about you, but I'm a huge sports fan. I love sports. I played sports. And I'm really missing sports right now, actually. I'm tired of reruns of old games and throwback games. I want to see LeBron dunk it on somebody and win another title. But anyway, that's my own reality. But in sports, specifically professional sports, teams often watch film of their opponents. They will analyze previous game footage so that they can learn the tendencies and the strategies of their team, of the team that they're going up against. Knowing this information can give one team an edge over their opponent, which in turn helps them win the game. So in this Invisible Enemy series, we'll examine who our opponent is and what tactics that are deployed against us as believers. And my prayer is that over this next couple of weeks, knowing this information will give you an edge so that you're victorious in battle. But also, we have a really cool thing that we're doing with this series is we're going to do a Q&A session at the end of this series. So in probably 5 weeks from now, we're going to do a Q&A. And so we want you to ask questions. So after every sermon each week, feel free to ask questions. If you have something you want to know more about or whatever the case is, we love to hear your questions. And actually, there's a link in the comments right now where you can go and you can submit a question. And we don't know how many questions are going to be, but we will try to answer as many of them as possible. So please, even right now as this sermon is going on, feel free to send in your questions. But today I want to talk about that this invisible enemy that I'm referring to is real. Is real. This enemy is real. Now I need you just to turn to the person sitting next to you who's watching with you and just let them know there is an enemy and you're in a battle. There is an enemy, and you're in a battle. If you're watching by yourself, just tell yourself, there is an enemy, and I'm in a battle. So who is our invisible enemy, you might ask? Well, I want to turn to Ephesians chapter 6, which gives us some insight about who this invisible enemy is. Now, before we look at this passage, I want to just make something very, very clear. When I say invisible enemy, I'm not referring to COVID-19. I know there's a lot of arrows in the grocery store, and maybe you feel like it's grocery warfare going on, but coronavirus is not the invisible enemy, and this is not a strategy to defeat that. I just want to be clear, because we can get real spiritual, but that is not what I'm referring to. Ephesians chapter 6 does describe who this invisible enemy that I'm referring to is. And so we're going to read beginning at verse number 10. Paul says, a final word, be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. Put on all of God's armor so that you will be able to stand firm against all strategies of the devil. For we are not fighting against flesh and blood enemies, but against evil rulers and authorities of the unseen world, against mighty powers in the dark world, and against evil spirits in the heavenly places. Therefore, put on every piece of God's armor so that you will be able to resist the enemy in the time of evil. Then after the battle, you will still be standing firm. Let's pray. God, we thank you for your word. We thank you for the opportunity to be in your presence. And God, as your word is declared, we ask that it would speak to our hearts, that you would give us wisdom, that you would give us power to defeat this foe, that we can walk victoriously as followers of Jesus Christ. God, we commit this time to you, and we ask that you would bless it and use it to change us from the inside out. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. This invisible enemy is real. As you look at the context of Ephesians chapter 6, earlier in this chapter, the Apostle Paul writes extensively on how believers are to live in community. He talks about how parents should relate to their children and how employees should relate to their employer. And in chapter 5 of Ephesians, Paul discusses how husbands and wives are to relate to one another. Now, after saying so much about how to live in these relationships, Paul's emphasis is that people are not our ultimate problem. See, relationships are a source of great joy and sorrow. Although raising children is a gift from God, it can also be very challenging. Come on, somebody who's stuck at home with their kids right now, or is, enjoying time with their kids right now. But many of us have had challenges raising kids, even on our jobs or in our work experiences. Some of you may have experienced how a boss or a coworker has treated you more like an enemy than a colleague. Even loving your spouse is a source of great intimacy and connection, but in difficult times, your spouse can feel more like an adversary than a partner. As human beings, we're capable of great love, but also great evil towards one another. We see abuse and discrimination and corruption and jealousy and envy and murder. All of these things are the effects of living and existing in a broken world. And as a consequence, it causes people to oppose one another. However, although people can sometimes feel like your enemy, people aren't our enemy. And I know this because Jesus commanded that we love our neighbor, not only just our neighbor, but we actually love our enemies and to pray for those who persecute you. Why? This is actually what Paul is trying to get at in this text, because humanity's true struggle is not against flesh and blood enemies. It's not against people, but against evil rulers and spiritual forces in heavenly places. In other words, Paul is saying everything that occurs and that is visible or physical is actually connected to a wrestling match being waged in the invisible or spiritual world. So this means is don't let problems or struggles in non-spiritual terms, or only see them in non-spiritual terms, because if we only see our struggles and problems in non-spiritual terms, then we'll only seek non-spiritual solutions. So this idea that Paul is alluding to is what we call spiritual warfare. Spiritual warfare. I like this definition. It says, spiritual warfare is the leveraging of everything that God promises against everything that opposes God's purposes. Spiritual warfare is leveraging of everything that God promises against everything that opposes God's purposes. So here is what I want us to know at this point. As followers of Jesus, you have an enemy, and you're in a battle. It's real. So who is this invisible enemy? Well, the text tells us that he's referred to as the devil. He's also referenced as Satan. Now, before I explain who Satan or the devil is, I need to make sure that we understand who the devil is not. Despite popular belief, this is not the devil. This cartoon character wearing a red jumpsuit with horns and carrying a pitchfork who rules a fiery underworld, that is not who the devil is as we understand in Scripture. So who is the devil? Well, let's examine the film. The devil is translated diablos in the Greek, which means slanderer or accuser. If we trace the origins of the devil in the Old Testament, we see that Satan or the devil makes an appearance in the books of Job and Zechariah. His job entails calling attention to the unworthiness of humanity. This accuser is essentially the prosecuting attorney of the divine court of Yahweh, and part of his role includes collecting evidence to find a case to build against humanity, that humanity are not really children of God, that we have flaws and we're sinful, and he makes accusation. He's the accuser in the court of God. We read in Isaiah chapter 14 and in Ezekiel chapter 28, as well as other biblical references that tell another story about Satan. He is described as the angel of light, the morning glory, arrayed in radiance and brilliance. He's this angelic being who was placed ahead, the head of the angelic hosts, and his chief job was to bring glory to God. But Satan decided he wanted the glory for himself. He wanted to sit on the throne where only God could sit, and so pride led to his downfall. And so Satan, what he does is he entices some of the angels to rebel against God. And as punishment for their rebellion, Satan is cast from heaven down to earth together with this rebellious entourage, which becomes demonic forces in the earth. As we flip over to the New Testament, the devil appears as this representative of evil. He is the antagonist in God's story of redemption. Satan goes by many names. Scripture refers to him as the enemy, a thief, a liar, the evil one, the tempter, the adversary, the old snake, the great dragon, Beelzebul, the prince of demons, and the god of this world. And his mission is he seeks to oppose the establishment of God's kingdom on earth. The devil attempts to seduce humanity into sin and disrupt God's plan for salvation. Jesus speaks to this cosmic tension in John chapter 10, verse 10, when he says, "The thief's or the devil's purpose is to steal and kill and destroy. My purpose is to give them a rich and satisfying life." Another translation says, "A life to the full." See, Jesus came to earth to establish God's kingdom. We read in Luke chapter 4 where Jesus says, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, for he has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim that captives will be released, that the blind will see, that the oppressed will be set free, and that the time of the Lord's favor has come." Jesus is making a messianic claim here, that he is the Christ, he is the anointed Son of God who has come to oppose the kingdom of darkness and destroy the works of Satan. So in the New Testament, there is less emphasis on the origin of Satan. Rather, it focuses on how Satan is defeated. Okay, you missed that. I'm going to say that again. In the New Testament, it's not as interested in the origins of Satan, how he came to be. It really focuses on how Satan has been defeated. That's good news, because although we have an enemy, he's a defeated foe. The New Testament is not telling the story of Satan. This is not to glorify the devil, but rather what becomes of Satan's authority when Jesus arrives to usher in the kingdom of God. Yes, the devil goes by many names, but even Satan has to bow down and humble himself before the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus Christ, every knee shall bow in heaven, on the earth, and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. See, the life, death, and resurrection of Christ is proof that Satan has been definitively defeated and Jesus has established God's power in the world. Someone just type flawless victory. Flawless victory. I remember playing this game called Mortal Kombat. Someone may know what I'm talking about. And when you really had a decisive, definitive victory, the game would say flawless victory. And that's what Jesus has done over Satan. It's flawless. It's definitive. But herein lies a tension, though, a theological tension. We establish that the devil is definitively defeated, yet he continues to act against Jesus and his followers. The role that Satan continues to play in the world is one aspect. It's a theological kind of tension where when we're talking about end times, and we're talking specifically about end times in the New Testament, there's this tension between the already and the not yet. How the kingdom of God has already arrived and has yet to be completely and ultimately established. There's this tension. And this means that Satan is here and now. He can still kind of exist, and he still has a mission. He still has strategies against believers. We read in 1 Peter chapter 5 and verse 8 describes how Satan prowls around like a roaring lion looking for someone to devour. He still seeks to corrupt the world, to undermine the faith of believers and steer people away from God. But there's coming a time, as the book of Revelation describes, where Satan will encounter his final judgment and his activity will cease. So as followers of Christ, we must recognize that we have an enemy and we're in a battle. And we must stay alert to the schemes and strategies of the devil. But I don't want anybody to misunderstand what I'm saying. I'm not suggesting that we give Satan more power than he deserves. Every mishap or misstep is not caused by the devil. Sometimes as Christians, we over-spiritualize what the devil is doing or not doing. And also, I want to add that the existence of Satan, the existence of the devil, does not negate human responsibility. God has given us free will. He's made us moral agents that we can still choose right from wrong. And so I don't want to get it twisted that every problem that happens in our life is just because Satan made me do it. That is not what this invisible enemy really is. However, there's another kind of opposite extreme in the belief of the devil. And that is that sometimes people don't believe that the devil exists at all. That Satan is actually some primitive or mythical idea that should be pushed out of Christian theology completely. But Paul reminds us in Ephesians chapter 6 that our enemy is real, and we must stand firm against his strategies that try to draw us away from God and into sin. Now, one of these strategies that the enemy deploys has captured the attention of our world in recent weeks. A video showing a police officer's knee pressing the life out of a helpless black man blew the lid off of a societal evil that we've all had to come face to face with called racism. And I want to be really clear with you today, Deepwater, that racism is not just ethically or morally wrong because it's unfair or it hurts somebody's feelings, but this is actually a deep spiritual issue. Racism is a mockery against the Creator who has created all of us in his image. Every human has intrinsic worth regardless of their ethnicity, and to deny that value based on the color of a person's skin is more than just wrong, it is sinful. Racism is sin, both individually and systemically in our society. It runs contrary to the message of the gospel and is inconsistent with true discipleship in Jesus Christ. And so as followers of Jesus, I want to encourage you today that we must challenge racism both in ourselves and in others. We cannot neglect our responsibility to speak to things that are unjust. What does the Lord require of you? Micah chapter 6 verse 8 asks. It says to act justly and to love mercy and to walk humbly with your God. As the church of Jesus Christ, we cannot let the enemy use racism as a device to divide us and to keep us silent. We must speak. We must stand against the strategies of Satan. This is how we battle the invisible enemy. We fight spiritual with spiritual. Because just in our human strength, it isn't enough. The scripture says we must be strengthened in the Lord and in his mighty power. Spiritual battles, if it's the evil of racism, or if it's a type of attack, or if it's a temptation, or if it's division, or if it's deception, any type of battle with Satan, it requires spiritual weapons. Spiritual battles require spiritual weapons. And so Paul tells us in verse 11, put on all of God's armor so that you will be able to stand firm against all strategies of the devil. Through the cross and resurrection of Christ, victory is already won. I'm going to say that again because that's good news. Through the cross and resurrection of Christ, victory is already won. The devil has lost. The only power he has is the power we give him. Are you hearing what I'm saying? The only power Satan has over us is the power that we give him. We are to stand firm in Christ's victory. Paul tells the Ephesians over and over to stand, to be firm, to resist. In other words, he's saying, stay in the area where victory has been achieved under the cover of God's armor. If we read down in verse 14, it tells us what this armor is. It says, stand your ground, putting on the belt of truth and the body armor of God's righteousness. For shoes, put on the peace that comes from the good news so that you will be fully prepared. In addition to all of these, hold up the shield of faith to stop the fiery arrows of the devil. Put on salvation as your helmet and take the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. I want to tell you today, church, that this invisible enemy is real. And we're in a spiritual battle. But be encouraged because we have an advocate who has overcome our adversary. And his name is Jesus. Would you pray with me this morning? God, we are so grateful that one of our spiritual weapons in spiritual warfare against this enemy is to pray. And so, God, we come and we come against all the strategies and schemes of the evil one. God, particularly, we want to destroy this evil called racism. God, we ask that it would be uprooted out of our own hearts, where we might have prejudice, where we might have been silent about things, where we wrestle with some stuff. God, would you just uproot in us things that hinder our ability to love one another? God, we repent. We ask for your forgiveness. We ask that you would cleanse us right now. Cleanse us of bigotry. Cleanse us of having wrong perceptions and making assumptions about people. God, would you give us the posture of listening and of loving well and of trying to follow Christ's example, that we go to those who are marginalized, that we're willing to fight for those who don't have a voice. God, would you give us, as the scripture says, would you give us strength through the mighty power of Christ? God, we just systemically come against Satan's schemes. God, one scripture talks about how Satan is the god of systems. And so, God, we pray that you would tear down the systemic causes and effects of racism, where groups of people are disproportionately affected and marginalized in a various amount of ways, where there's a historical thread that has created inequities. God, we pray that you would make all things right. And God, may your church, your beautiful bride, be that witness of how a community of people, regardless of their background, regardless of their ethnicity, regardless of their gender, can stand together, not as the same, but as one in you, Christ Jesus. God, we can't win this battle without you, and so we ask that you would strengthen us. We ask that you would help us to stand under your victory, Jesus, that you have victory over racism. You have victory over discrimination. You have victory over every strategy and scheme of the enemy. And God, we just speak and pray unity over our church, over our world, that justice will prevail. And God, we just pray that in all things you will be glorified and we would be edified. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Just a couple of announcements before we finish up for the day. I mentioned this last week, but I just want to emphasize it again, that we as a church, we as Deepwater, feel that the best way to serve and love our church and our community is to continue to meet and to gather online. And so this is what we're going to continue to do for over the summer months, is just gather together here as a staff and try to put together worship experiences that you can connect with and engage with, and also invite your friends and family and people that maybe don't know Jesus into, and just continue to strategize and find ways to connect and to be the church, the scattered church. And so I just want to remind everyone of that is how we're trying to fulfill Christ's mission in this season. Also, it kind of in relation to that, we decided that starting today, you probably would have seen it today, that we moved to two worship gathering times. And so you can worship at 9 a.m. Or 11 a.m. There'll be a live stream of our worship gathering. And of course, our upstream children's ministry gathers at 10 a.m. as well. So you have two options now. So I hope that serves you well and gives more people the opportunity to connect into worship together. If you're new to Deepwater, maybe this is the first time you're tuning in, we're so grateful that you have tuned in, and we want you to not only just experience this gathering, but we want you to be connected. And so if you want to connect with us, if you want to learn more about our church, the next best step for you is to get a Next card, and we have an online card for you to fill out. You'll see that in the comments. You just fill out your information, your name and email, phone number, and that will sign you up for our weekly email newsletter called The Loop, and that will keep you up to date with everything that's happening in the life of our church. And just one more thing I want to share. Part of our our mission forward is we are grateful for everyone who continues to give financially to our church. And so I just invite you and encourage you to give, to contribute, to continue to contribute financially and to worship and serve God through your giving, which enables us to continue the work of ministry here at Deepwater. And so you can give through all of our regular channels, online, email money transfer through our Deepwater Church app. Also, we still have our mail slot available on our Fuller Street entrance of our church in Halifax, our actual church building. And so it's a very secure spot where you can give your offering if you give envelope or cash or check. That's available to you as well. And so we just thank you in advance for your contributions to our church and to God. Let us join together for the benediction. Now all glory to God, who is able, through his mighty power at work within us, to accomplish infinitely more than we can ask or think. Glory to him in the church and in Christ Jesus through all generations, forever and ever. Amen. Have a blessed week, and we hope to see you back next week. Take care.